Good morning, students. Today I am going to teach BA final year paper 1 poetry and drama, and the name of the poem is There is Pleasure in the Pathless Woods. This poem is written by Lord Byron, whose full name is George Gordon Byron, and he was born on 22nd January 1788 and he died on 19th April 1824. He was also the leading figure of the Romantic movement. Now, Childe Harold's Pilgrimage is a long narrative poem. And another point to remember is that this poem, which is in your syllabus, that is, There is a Pleasure in the Pathless Wood, is the canto 4 of this long narrative poem, whose title is Childe Harold's Pilgrimage. This poem is semi-autobiographical nature. And one more thing to remember about this long narrative poem, that is Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, is that the publication of this poem caused Byron to remark, I quote, "I awoke one morning and found myself famous," unquote. And this poem was published in 1812, and with this publication it brought sudden fame and renown to Lord Byron. So let's begin the poem. There is a pleasure in the pathless woods. Pleasure means happiness, and pathless woods refers to forest trails. There is a rapture means excitement or pleasure on the lonely shore, that is on the seashore where nobody intrudes, nobody comes. What the poet means to say is that even the solitude is to be enjoyed. There is a society. Now here the seashore is personified, and he says that though nobody intrudes at the seashore, but still in the silence, in the solitude, in the loneliness, there is a society where none intrudes. Intrudes means comes. By the deep sea and music in its roar, that the coming and going of the waves, the receding and falling of the waves on the seashore, all this causes a roar, a kind of music. I love this. Next line is very meaningful. I love not man the less, but nature more. Now this refers to that although human beings, they are social beings, but still the poet says that he does not hate human beings, but he prefers the company of nature. From all I may be or have been before, that whatever the poet is, to mingle with the universe, to be one with the nature and feel what I can never express. When he is one with the universe, when he is one with the nature. So what he feels, a kind of pleasure, a kind of rapture, and what he feels with nature, he has no words to express, yet he cannot conceal this happiness when he is in union with nature. Now, the next stanza refers to the ocean, the strength of the ocean. Roll on, thou deep and dark blue ocean, roll. 10,000 fleets. Fleets is a group of ships. Sweep. Sweep means float over thee in vain. Vain means futile. The ocean is so huge, and big fleets, they sail over the oceans. But it is their strength as compared to the ocean is in vain. It is futile. Man marks the earth with ruin. Man, he has destroyed Mother Earth. He has dug caves. He has done mining, quarrying, etc. So he has caused a lot of damage to Mother Earth. But man's control stops with the shore. That is, he is powerless when it comes to ocean or the water bodies. Upon thy watery plain, that the ocean, the plain, the plains of the earth, is where man can cause a lot of havoc and destruction. But the plains of the ocean, here man cannot even lay his foot. The wrecks means destruction are all thy deeds, sinking of huge ships, everything, you know, they all are the works of the deeds of the ocean. Nor doth remain a shadow of man's ravage. Ravage means damage. That ocean or the water body is so powerful that if it decides to cause destruction to a human being, not even his shadow would be visible. Save his own when for a moment like a drop of rain. Sinking of a human being in a huge ocean is just like falling of a drop, rain droplet, and it is lost. So a human being, a man who is drowned in the ocean, his existence would be lost just like a rain droplet in an ocean. He sinks into thy depths with bubbling groan. Groan means painful sound. And the mighty ocean, if it destroys, it decides to destroy a human being, he will dissolve in the length and breadth of the ocean with bubbling or with painful sounds without a grave. And he's so powerless, the human being, that he will die in the ocean and no grave would be made on his dead body, unknelled. And knell refers to the death bell, which is rung at the time of the death of somebody or at somebody's funeral. So when a human being dies in ocean, he'll die unknelled, uncoffined. No coffin would be brought to him because his dead body would not be found, and nobody would know where the human being has sunk and died. So as human being is powerless when it comes to the comparing his strength with the strength of the ocean. His steps are not upon thy paths, thy fields. Human beings can walk on earth, but they cannot walk on the ocean, are not a spoil for him. And human beings have looted the mother earth, but they cannot loot the ocean. Thou does arise. Now this refers to ocean. Ocean is personified. It is treated as a human being. The ocean might arise and shake him from thee. And if there is a human being who's trying to do something with the depths of the ocean, he's trying to do any commercial activity, what if the ocean decides? It will gather all its strength and the wild strength he wields, and the human being possesses worthless strength as compared to the ocean. For earth's destruction thou dost all despise, because human being has destroyed the earth so much that the ocean hates human beings, spurning him means rejecting him, thy bosom to the skies. And what the ocean will do, it will throw back the human being against the sky and sensed him shivering in thy playful spray. For the ocean, it might be just throwing off a playful spray of waves, but for the human beings, the strength of the ocean is so mighty and howling to his gods that he will, at the time of danger, he will remember his gods, where happily, where by chance lies his petty hope in some near port or bay. Perhaps there is a temple or a place of worship of human beings at some port or bay where human being remembers God and he begs for mercy for his life to be saved, and dashes him. That dash means to throw against him to earth. There let him lay. And what if the ocean decides, it will gather all its strength and throw away the human being and hit him against the seashore. The armaments. Now, armaments refers to the military weapons which thunderstrike the walls of rock-built cities. There are some cities which have very, very progressive military weapons. But ocean is still more powerful, bidding nations quake. And perhaps there might be some nations which tremble at the knowledge that there are some very destructive military weapons, and monarchs tremble in their capitals. The Lord of thee means any nation which has a very powerful navy and arbiter of war. And a nation which has a powerful navy is also the arbiter or settler of war. That whichever nation has a very strong navy will emerge as winner in any kind of war. These are thy toys, but these armaments, powerful ships, submarines, etc., these are toys for the ocean. That yet ocean is more powerful. And as the snowy flake, they melt into thy yeast, means froth or bubble of waves, which mar alike the armada's pride or spoils of Trafalgar. It means even very powerful ships or fleet or very destructive weapons, they are like toys to this ocean. Armada's pride, this refers to the invincible armada or the Spanish fleet which was sent against England in 1588, and it was defeated by the English and later destroyed by storm. So what is to be noted? That this armada, the Spanish fleet, which was also given the name Invincible, was destroyed by a storm caused in the sea or ocean, or spoils of Trafalgar. Now, Trafalgar refers to the Spanish and French fleet, which were defeated by English under Nelson. So, now let's come to the next answer. The shores are empires. Now, this refers to the setting of the Mediterranean Sea and all the countries which are surrounding the Mediterranean Sea. History has shown that they were great empires and their old names were Assyria, Greece, Rome, Carthage. What are they? So, it is the Mediterranean Sea or the water bodies which has given power to these sea-facing or the empires which are at the seashore. Thy waters washed them powers. The waters of the Mediterranean Sea gave power to these empires while they were free, and many a tyrant since and many cruel rulers have ruled these empires. Their shores obey the stranger, slave or savage, through water or through ships. A stranger, slave or savage would come to these huge empires and would start ruling. So it is the water of these water bodies which gave power to these bordering empires and brought a stranger, slave or savage to rule these empires. Their decay has dried up realms to deserts. And all those, history has shown, those great empires, the state, the countries, now they have decayed. The water has also given power to these empires and has also destroyed these great empires by flood. Not to thou unchangeable save, but the ocean, the water body is unchangeable. Save except to thy wild waves play. Only the playful nature of the waves, it is changing. The waves come and go, there is a ripple effect and there is a sea storm. Except for the activities of the water, everything remains the same in the sea. Time writes no wrinkle. Even the time which destroys or which has made, which has aged everybody, but it could not age the water body or the ocean. On thine azure brow. Brow refers to the forehead, azure blue, the reflection of the sky on the water body. Such as creation's dawn beheld, when the creation began, when it was the first dawn of the creation, the water bodies are same as it used to be. There is no aging, except the only change in water bodies is the movement in the waves. Thou rollest now, and the oceans, the water bodies continue to roll, the water continues to flow. Thou glorious mirror, and the water bodies are like mirrors, that is, they reflect where the Almighty's form glasses itself. The sky is reflected in the water bodies in tempests, and God's wrath is manifested through the storms in the oceans. In all time, calm or convulsed, whether the time is calm, peaceful, or the time is violent, in breeze, gale or storm, whatever is the condition of the blowing wind, whether it is pleasant, whether it is strong, and whether it is in the form of a tempest, icing the poles, it might be very cold wind, or in the torrid, it might be, the climate might be very hot, dark, heaving. What the ocean is, it is dark, it is heaving, it is breathing very deeply, boundless, it is endless and sublime, and the ocean is grand, the image of eternity. And the ocean is boundless, it cannot be overpowered, the throne of the invisible, it is the throne, the seat of the God, the oceans, the throne of the invisible. Even from out thy slime, and in the waterbed under the ocean, there is a lot of slime or mud, the monsters of the deep are made. Life is found in the at the base of the ocean, each zone obeys thee. The earth is divided, the universe is divided into several zones, and all the zones, they obey the ocean. Thou goest forth, the ocean goes to and fro, dread, fathomless, alone. It is alone, and everybody is in awe of the mighty ocean. Now, there is a change in the thought of the poem, and there is a personal touch, which is also quality of the romantic poets, that they used to introduce a personal element in the poetry. And I refers to the poet, and I have loved the ocean. He has loved the ocean, and my joy of youthful sports was on thy breast to be borne like the bubble onwards. Now, here the mood, the tone is nostalgic, and he remembers his childhood when he used to be indulged in water activities on the ocean. He used to be carried on the waves of the ocean, just like the modern activities of water surfing. From a boy, I wantoned play. When he was a boy, during his childhood, he used to play with thy beakers, means the waves of the ocean. They to me were a delight, and in his boyhood, Byron used to feel very delightful in the company of playing with the waves of the ocean. And if the freshening sea, that means if the speed of the sea was increased, it was tumultuous, made them a terror, and it was terrifying for others. It was a pleasing fear, because the poet was young, he had strength, he was full of energy. He never feared the strength of the freshening sea, for I was as it were a child of thee. Now he imagines himself as a child of ocean, and trusted to thy hand, he trusted, as a child trusts mother, he trusted the ocean, and he played with the waves of the ocean, and he played in the large waves far and near, and laid my hand upon thy mane. Mane is the long hair which are found on the neck of a horse. So when you ride without a saddle or reins, you just hold on to the mane of the horse and you ride. So he used to ride the water, the waves of the ocean, just like one rides a wild horse holding on it to its mane. Now next stanza, my task is done. Now this is the last part of this poem. The task of writing the poem is over. My song had ceased. His poem is almost over. My theme has died into an echo. Now the theme has also completed. It is fit the spell should break of this protracted dream. Protracted means prolonged. That is, writing of this poem is just like a long dream. And he says that this dream should come to an end, and writing of this poem is like an enchantment, a magic or a spell, and the spell should come to an end. The torch shall be extinguished. Torch refers to the light or the inspiration. Now the poet's inspiration of writing this long narrative poem is also ending. And what is writ is writ. Whatever I have written it. Now there is a wish, would it were worthier. Now he's wishing. This is the wish of every artist. He feels that his poem should be worthy. But I am not now that which I have been. Now he's changed after writing this beautiful semi-autobiographical poem. He feels that he's changed. And my visions flit. He's tired now. Less palpably before. He's feeling. And the glow, that is the inspiration, the inner inspiration, which is a work of God or the nature which has inspired him, this inspiration is also flitting. His sights are flitting, which in my spirit dwelt is fluttering faint, it is dying and low. Now the last stanza of the poem, farewell. It is true, a word that must be and hath been, yes. You all know, students, how difficult it is to say goodbye or to farewell. So the poet is also feeling bad to bid goodbye. This is the last part of the poem. A sound which makes us linger means stay longer. We don't want to, when we say goodbye to our friends or to anyone we love, we don't want to say goodbye. We want to prolong it, prolong the goodbye. Yet farewell, ye who have traced the pilgrim to the scene. Pilgrim refers to the hero or the poet. Now he tells the reader who have followed the pilgrim or the hero to the pilgrimage, which is his last. If in your memories dwelt a thought which once was his. So he's telling the reader, if even one thought you can share which belonged to the poet once, that means he's successful as a poet. If one ye swell, a single recollection not, and then his efforts are not in vain, they are not wasted. Now the poet is comparing himself to a pilgrim, and he says he wore his sandal shoe, means a special kind of shoes which were worn by the pilgrims, and a scallop shell which was also worn by pilgrims in medieval times. So he says ki my pilgrimage is worth taking if the reader remember a single thought which belonged to me or the poet. So my pilgrimage has not gone in vain. If such there, farewell with him alone may rest the pain. If such there were with you.